It was almost exactly 60 years ago, on March 27th, 1958, that Columbia Records announced they had invented the stereophonic record. This was their very first one they released, catalog number SF1, Listening in Depth, an Introduction to Columbia Stereophonic Sound. It contains this very nice booklet talking about the new listening of stereo records, the cartridge they had released to play them, which, by the way, tracked at 6 grams. For those of you who think that kind of tracking force is going to ruin your records, that's what the very first stereo cartridge from Columbia tracked at. They show a microscope view of the groove and everything. They talk about the RIAA curve. A very nice detailed booklet. So that was the very first stereo record released by Columbia Records in March 1958. But did you know somebody else was making stereo records as far back as 1952? And that was Emory Cook of Cook Laboratories of Stamford, Connecticut. As it says here, this is a duplex recording. This record can be played on either regular LP or binaural machines. For standard LP listening, play only the outside band in the ordinary way. By itself, this band is an ideal point source single microphone pickup. For binaural listening, a two-headed arm or Cook binaural clip conversion is necessary in order to play both bands of grooves simultaneously. Here it is. The binaural stereo record. I believe this one was actually released in 1954. Each side of the record has two tracks that play the same thing for the left and right channels. So that was Emory Cook's crazy way to get two channels of sound on a record. Instead of putting them both into one groove, he put two tracks that would be played with two needles, two cartridges, on the same turntable. Kind of funny that the Columbia record, which I'm playing in the background, has a sound of a steam train on it, because that was actually Emory Cook's first big hit, a recording of steam trains on a record called Rail Dynamics, which he released in mono in 1950, and it turned out to be surprisingly popular, and that's what really launched his recording career, because Emory Cook, the guy who ran Cook Laboratories, didn't have recording contracts or even his own recording studio. So what he did, he took his tape recorder out in the field, either by train tracks or by the sea in this one, or he would even find people playing music and he would stop and he would start recording them, and he would pay them some nominal fee to get the rights to the recording, and then he would release it. And that's how most of his catalog was formed. And that was his road recording series. This one says, a collection of many sounds relating to the sea and those who travel upon it, Queen Mary whistle, pebbly surf, sandy surf, the USS Columbus harbor sounds. I know this picture doesn't look very sea-like, but he used this picture on all of his road recordings releases. Now, as mentioned, in order to play one of these records in stereo, you would need either a two-headed arm or a conversion clip that would add a second cartridge onto your existing tone arm. And there's actually a video on YouTube of somebody who has one of those two-headed arms using it to play one of these binaural records. And I'll include a little clip of that here. Now, this is not to be confused with the other definition of binaural record, which is that they would use a dummy head and they place the microphones exactly where the ears are in the head. And that way, if you listen to these records using headphones, as they show here, you get almost a surround sound type effect. But back when these Cook binaural records were released, the term for stereo had not really been standardized. People didn't know whether to call it stereophonic, binaural, or even 3D sound. They were sort of testing out each one of those terms to see which one would stick, and in the end, stereo won. So these records were stereo sound before it was even called stereo sound. So these records are a fascinating piece of history, an early concept of how you would put stereo sound on a record. Obviously, this kind of system was not practical in the long run, because the system that eventually won, which was called the Westrex 4545 system, because it involved two 45 degree angles in the cutter head to put the lateral and vertical movements of the stylus into the groove, that was actually being experimented with since the 1930s.
I am now talking into the microphone, which will actuate the vertical side of the recorder. Mr. Patterson is in the room with me now, and he is standing some 8 feet from me, talking, and he will shortly talk into another microphone. Will you say a few words, Mr. Patterson?
Yes, that's correct. I'm about 8 feet to the right of Keller, and I'm speaking into a microphone, which I understand is hooked up to the lateral side of the system.
So that was already existing technology by the time these Cook binaural records were released. But it took a long time for that system to be perfected, so in the meantime, Mr. Cook thought that this system of using two tracks on one side and a two-headed tone arm would be a more practical approach. And it ended up lasting until 1957, when he stopped making these binaural records and started re-releasing his material in the system that ended up becoming the standard. Now, if you come across one of these records today and you want to play it and you don't have one of those crazy adapters or tone arms with the two cartridges mounted on it, there is a way to play one of these, except not in real time. What you have to do is play the whole thing through and record it into a computer, and then you can split the left and right tracks and line them up. Now, in order to make this work well, you need a turntable with a very stable speed, so obviously I won't be using my Crosley to do that. I'll be using my Technics turntable, which is direct drive and does have very stable speed. So once I got those two tracks lined up, it stayed pretty much perfectly in sync throughout the whole side of the record. And needless to say, the stereo separation of one of these records, once you get it all set up, is far superior to a conventional stereo record, where the best you can really get out of one of these is about 30 dB or so. With one of these, you have unlimited stereo separation. It's only limited by whatever the original recording had. And Mr. Cook would place his microphones usually 10 feet apart, so it got a very wide soundstage. In fact, during some portions of this recording, he was on a ship, and I think he placed one microphone inside a cabin and another microphone out on the deck. So it gave a very interesting sound effect. And there are several websites which talk about Emory Cook and his recordings. It's a fascinating piece of history of a system that was pioneering in stereo sound, but obviously did not become the standard because it was just too complex to set up and use. But for those people who were on the bleeding edge of technology back in the 1950s, they may have gotten their first exposure to stereo sound from one of these records. And I'll play a little clip of it here now. You'll see two video clips superimposed on top of each other showing the two tracks being played, and obviously I'll sync them up in editing to give you the proper stereo effect.
all right, Mac.